I'm glad you're here to worship with us this morning. Before we get into worship, we're going to go ahead and open up in prayer. We'll come back. We'll do announcements after worship before the word. So let's go ahead and bow our heads in prayer, and then we'll get into worship. Father God, we thank you for this morning. Lord, I thank you for just all that you're doing in our midst. I pray, Lord, that you would continue to draw us to yourself, that you would quicken in us a desire to worship, a desire to lift up our voices, lift up our hearts and our minds, our lives to you, Lord, to make a sacrifice of praise. I pray, Lord, that you would meet us in this place as we do, as we make much of you, that you would meet us in this place and change hearts and transform minds and change the way we live and think and act. Help us to build one another up and encourage one another down this path of becoming like you. It's in your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
You guys just want to stand and worship.
When you walk into the room, everything changes. Darkness starts to tremble at the light that you bring. When you walk into the room, every heart starts burning. Nothing matters more than just to sit here at your feet and worship you. We worship you when you walk into the room. Everything changes, and darkness starts to tremble at the light that you bring. When you walk into the room, every heart starts burning, and nothing matters more than just to sit here at your feet and worship you. We worship you. And we love you, and we'll never stop. We can't live without you, oh Jesus. We love you, and we can't get enough. All this is for you, oh Jesus. Oh, Jesus. When you walk into the room, sickness starts to vanish. Every hopeless situation, it ceases to exist. And when you walk into the room, the dead begin to rise, 'cause there is resurrection life in all you do. Jesus, we love you, and we'll never stop. We can't live without you, oh Jesus. We love you, and we can't get enough. All this is for you, oh Jesus. So come and consume, God, all we are. We give you permission, our hearts are yours. We want you, we want you. To come and consume, God, all we are. We give you permission, our hearts are yours. We want you, we want you to come. To come and consume, God, all we are. We give you permission, our hearts are yours. We want you, yeah, we want you. come and consume, God, all we are. We give you permission, our hearts are yours. We want you. We want you. And we love you. We'll never stop. We can't live without you. And we can't get enough. Oh, this is for you, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. We love you. We love you. And we'll never stop, we can't live without you, oh Jesus. We love you, and we can't get enough. Oh, this is for you, Jesus. Jesus, I need you to soften my heart, to break me apart. I need you to open my eyes, to see that you're shaping my life. And all I am, I serve. Trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life. And I need you. Break me apart. I need you to pierce through the dark and cleanse every part of me. And all I am, I trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life. I may be weak, your spirit strong in me, and my flesh may fail, but my God, you never will. I may be weak, but your spirit strong in me, and my flesh may fail, but my God, you never will. I may be your spirit strong in me, and my flesh may fail, but my God, you never will. Give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life. I may be weak, but your spirit's strong in me. And my flesh may fail, but my God, you never will. Yeah, I may be weak, Lord, but your spirit's strong in me. And my flesh may fail, but my God, you never will. I may be weak, but your spirit's strong in me. And my flesh may fail, but my God, you never will. So give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life. Lord, you're more real than the ground I'm standing on. You're more real than the wind in my lungs. You're more real. Yeah, you're more real than the ground I'm standing on. You're more real than the wind in my lungs. Your thoughts define me, and you're inside of me. You're my reality. You're so real to me. So above, I belong to you. Oh, closer than the skin on my bones, you're closer. You're closer than the song on my tongue. You're so much closer. You're closer. You're closer than the skin on my bones. And you're closer than the song on my tongue. Your thoughts define me, inside of me. You're my reality. Abba, you're so real to me. So Abba, do. Oh, Abba, I belong to you. I do. Oh, Abba, Abba, I belong to on the way back home, in the arms of the Father who won't let go. You came running down my prodigal road. You came running with the ring and the robe, and grace is the collision on the way back home, with the arms of the Father who won't let go. So Abba, I belong to you. I do, it's true. I do. Oh, Abba, Abba, I belong to you. Oh, Abba, I belong to you. Yes, Abba, I belong to you. Abba, Abba, forsake me. Abba, Abba, yes, I have a Father, and He really loves me. Abba, Abba, He'll never leave me, He'll never forsake me. Abba, I have a Father, and He really loves me. Abba, Abba, and He'll never leave me, He'll never unstoppable. I belong to you.
Into this next song, I just want you guys to think about what we just sang, about how we have a Father, about how when He walks into the room, everything changes, and He comes in, and sickness vanishes, and darkness fears. The God that when we cry out, when we ask, God, would you give me faith? This is the God that we know. This is the God who desires to know us more and more and more. So as we go into this next song, I just encourage you guys to think about what you're saying about. Who is Jesus? Who is the Lord? He's worthy. Jesus is the name that's above every other name. And He's holy and He's perfect. And yet He decides that He's going to dwell within us. He's going to be yoked with us. He's going to walk through life with us. And I hate to break it to you, but we don't deserve that. And we couldn't do anything to earn that. And yes, yet He chooses to. So just, I just encourage you. So just sing. Sing and worship the Lord because He's so worthy of it. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. Worthy of all the praise we could ever sing, we live for you, we live for you.
Let's sing that again.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you, we live for you, Jesus. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you, oh, we live for you, holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you, open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me and your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. And we sing. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me, Lord. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me and your love to those around me. Yes, Jesus. Lord, in view of all that you are, Lord, in view of all that you've done, Lord, would we see you rightly? Spirit of wisdom and revelation, would you give us eyes and hearts to see you rightly and hear you rightly? Lord, would you give us hearts of worship that are so enamored by who you are that we just want to sit and look at you? But that would be the one desire, the one thing that we ask for, and the one thing that we seek, Lord. To see you and worship you and bring you glory. Would that be our hearts? Because everything pours out of that, Jesus. We can't love one another. Lord, we can't stop sinning. We can't have good relationships. We can't do good at our jobs. God, we can't even pump gas without you. We can't do anything without you. Jesus, would you give us a viewpoint of you that's right? Would you show us who you are, and would you fill us with your heart, Lord? And from there, from this relationship on the vertical plane, would we love on the horizontal plane like we've been talking about? Lord, would we see the people on the horizontal plane the way that you see them, because we're so enamored by you on the vertical plane? Jesus, we can't do anything on this horizontal plane without being connected on the vertical. So would we be so connected, because you're so worthy of our worship, and not just in song, but you're worthy in how we talk to people, Lord, how we spend our time, how we read your word, how we talk to you. Jesus, just how we view you, because either you're worth our time or you're not worth our time. If we make you a priority, it's because we've seen you rightly and we realize how important you are. And if we don't, then we haven't seen you rightly. Because seeing you rightly, Jesus, should change something in our hearts. So I pray, God, that right now you'd give everyone in this room an adequate view of who you are. That we would see you. That we would see you rightly. Jesus, would we just see you rightly? Would we see you as Abba? Would we see you as healer? Would we see you as the one who walks in the room and darkness vanishes and sickness vanishes? Because that's who you are, Jesus. Would we see you as the one who's given us faith? Would we see you as the one that we can trust? The one that we can lean on? The one who doesn't change when everything around us changes? Would we see you as that God? Would we see you as that Jesus? Lord, we thank you that we get the privilege of coming to worship you. We thank you for the privilege of being in your presence, God. In your name, amen.
Chorus, whatever, right? That's a prayer that the Lord desires to answer. The question is did you really mean it? Right? Are you willing to go out and be led in in His love to those around you? If that's truly your heart's cry, I do believe this week that He will give you opportunities to do just that. Right? I believe that is a prayer that He desires to answer and put into willing vessels, and He'll lead you and me to those people that are in need of His love. I really do. And its question is just, are we willing to go down that path? So, again, good morning and welcome. A couple of announcements before we get into the message and continue in our series on 1 John. Next Sunday, there's a financial board meeting after service. So if you're interested in the finances of the church and where we're going, 20 minutes-ish after service, we meet in the conference room. So if you go out and it's to the right on the conference room there. So that's next Sunday, June 12th. And then June 26th, there's still opportunity for baptism that Sunday. If you've never taken the step of baptism and you'd like to take that step of baptism and publicly declare your faith by going under the waters of baptism, please see myself or one of the elders, where we can get you connected on that front. We'd love to help you take that next step in your walk with the Lord. It is definitely a step of obedience. I think it is a step that, you know, meant to be kind of one of those very initial steps of obedience. And so if you're here this morning or you're online and you're sitting going, you know, I've been a believer for 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, I've never taken the step. That's okay. I still encourage you to take that step now, because that is a step of obedience that I believe the Lord desires for you and me to walk in as we continue to go forth into the waters of baptism. With that being the announcements, we're going to continue our series this morning in the book of 1 John. We've got several weeks to go. We're going to wrap up chapter 3 here this morning. We're going to continue on the idea or the topic of love. We talked about it last week, about our need to love one another. That is a huge indicator of our faith in Christ and the fact that our lives are transformed and we're actually loving one another, not just by walking by somebody and saying, I love you, but actually with practical deeds, right? That we're actually doing stuff, we're actually making sacrifice down that path, and actually starting to live that out on an ongoing basis. And so we're going to be in chapter 3 of 1 John, verses 19 through 24, and it kind of breaks into two sections. Kind of a break from the topic, right? It's a continuation of love, but it's this interlude. If you remember back in chapter 2, when he starts to talk about, I'm writing to you sons and I'm writing to you fathers and such, like this encouragement that came on in chapter 2 after running through some tests. It's the same thing here in chapter 3. He's laid out this need of love, and he brings us back and he And he wants to assure his readers, and he wants to assure you and I, that we truly are saved, that our salvation is real, and that our hearts can rest. Because I have a feeling, I'm not much different than many of you in this room, and maybe you didn't this week, but maybe in the last month, or maybe going forward you will, but you're going to have some questions about your faith. And your conscience, what John refers to in these verses as your heart, may bring forth condemnation in your life because you're not walking in love, or you're not walking in obedience to his commands, or you're not doing the things that please Christ, and you know it, and that conscience that God has given you is going to rear up, right? And he's going to start to swirl accusations. And what do we do with those accusations when they come? And John wants to give us this morning that encouragement that goes, when that happens, it's okay. Right? We can kind of put those things at rest. We can put those things at peace and be reassured that our salvation is real. Yes, we may have stumbled. We may have fallen. We may have not walked in a way that was pleasing to the Lord yesterday, right? But that can be let go of. That can be forgiven. And we can walk forward in confidence knowing who you and I are in Christ as his beloved sons and daughters. So, two portions this morning for you note takers out of there. It breaks into these two points. The foundations of our assurance, which is verses 19 through 20. Right, so that we'll look at that what's the basis of this assurance that we can have, that John wants you and I to have. And then the second half, 21 through 24, is the blessings that come out of that assurance, out of that confidence, out of that spot of confidence in our relationship with the Lord. Right, it will be 21 through 24. So right out of the gate here this morning, there are two different ways that we can look at this passage. As I was going through many commentaries this week, you start to read it and you start to understand it. Some commentators, right, some theologians out there take it that this is a correction, a rebuke, a warning to those who aren't walking in love. Right, so they'll take these verses that we'll read here in a minute and they'll start to go, you know what, these are just a wake-up call to those who aren't consistently making a conscious effort to live love out with other people. They'll say it in word, and that's it. And so they say that John is trying to bring correction to those people. As you'll notice, it just kind of shoot down, if you will, real quick. Let's see if we can find it here. Verse 20. For whenever our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart, and he knows everything. And so they take that verse, and when we start to get in this spot of condemnation, these theologians, they think that John is actually saying, you know what? You know how bad it is? Actually, God's condemnation is even greater. And his judgment is even more severe. And so you should really fix that. You should really change that today while you still can. Not that that's necessarily wrong, but most commentaries, most theologians out there don't think that that lines up with the structure of 1 John chapter 3 as a whole. 1 John chapter 3 as a whole is talking about the love of the Father. Remember back in verse 1, right? Imagine, right? Look into, gaze at this love the Father has poured on you as his sons and his daughters. And then he continues on as we looked last week, and he gives us affirmation that if we're loving one another, we're his sons and daughters as well. And so we need to think of it in that mindset that John is coming alongside and he wants you and I to have assurance. He wants us to be able to look at our lives and go, I know that I know that I know that I'm a son or a daughter. And that even when your conscience convicts you, condemns you, right, don't let that be the last call. Because it's not. It's not the last call on your life. Your conscience doesn't get to say guilty or innocent. God does. Right? Jesus does. And he's already made that decision through his life, death, and resurrection. That if you've put your trust and faith in him, he's declared you innocent, correct? So no matter what your conscience says this morning, if you're sitting and you've had a rough week and your conscience is just condemning and piling guilt, stop it. Right? Holy Spirit, just stop that thought process that's going on in a brother or sister's mind. And take that away that they realize there is no condemnation in you. That there's no condemnation in Christ. So that's where we're shifting, if you will, down this path as we go down this road here this morning. Thinking about salvation specifically, R.C. Sproul talks about some four different points, if you will, of what salvation is. There are four different positions we could be in. The first one is there's those who are unsaved, and they know it. And I pray that that's none of you here this morning, but if it is, and you know that you're unsaved, that's a good place to be. You know that you're in need, potentially. Right? And you admit to that fact. So there's one state of salvation that we can have assurance in. I don't make any claim on salvation. It's not me. I don't want that. Right? Or you could be in the second phase. There are people who are saved but do not know they are saved. They doubt their salvation, perhaps to a troubled conscience. That's what we're going to focus on this morning. I believe that's what John is poking at this morning. He goes, they're saved, But they're just struggling with that. They're doubting that. They're wondering, is it real? Is it not real? How can this happen? And the accusations are flying. John wants to correct those things. The third sport of salvation could be those who are saved and they know it. And that's where John desires us all to be. John, 1 John 5:13, I write these things that you may know your eternal salvation is real. So that's John's whole purpose of writing the book as a whole. He desires every one of us, I desire every one of us in this room, to be at that spot. That we're saved, and we know we're saved, and we have a confidence in that, because I think out of that confidence, now we start to go and do the things, and we start to love people, what Tasia prayed this morning. Right? If our vertical plane is right, and we're confident in that, the horizontal plane starts to work its way out. If this vertical plane isn't set, I don't know if I can really work on the horizontal plane. Because I'm not sure who I am, and I'm not certain than this, and I'm still trying to earn my way there or whatever. But when the vertical plane is set, which is what John desires for us this morning, when that's set and we know it, the horizontal starts to flourish because we can live out of that relationship and that understanding. And then the fourth one is those who think they're saved and they're self-deceived. Right? Their basis of salvation is on something completely wrong, but they're convinced in their own mind they're good. And I think that's the most dangerous of the four. Right? That I'm good, I'm saved, but really I'm not. And so I pray that as we go through here this morning, maybe some of that gets confronted a little bit as well, going down that path. But as I said, we're going to look at this second phase. We're saved, but we're questioning, we're struggling, we're doubting, our conscience is bringing conviction, and he wants to fix that this morning. So let's go ahead and read 1 John chapter 3, verses 19 through 24. John says this, "By this we shall know that we are of the truth, and we assure our hearts before him. For whenever our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart, and he knows everything. Beloved, if our heart does not condemn us, we have confidence before God. And whatever we ask, we receive from him, because we keep his commandments and do what pleases him. And this is his commandment, that we should believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as he commanded us. Verse 24, whoever keeps his commandments abides in God, and God in him. And by this we know that he abides in us by the Spirit whom he has given to us." Right, so there's our portion, there's our scripture for this morning. Now let's break that down a little bit. Verses 19 through 20, the foundations of our assurance. Right, verse 19, did you catch it there? By this. Right, so it's crucial that we understand what the by this is pointing to. Right, by what, John? What are you saying? By this we shall put our hearts at rest before him and assure it. Right. So by this, he's pointing backwards, if you will, back up to verses 17 and 18. But if anyone has the world's goods and deeds and sees his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how does God's love abide in him? Verse 18, little children, let us love in word or not in word or talk, but in deed and truth. John goes, if you're seeing your love in deed and truth, you can start to put your heart at rest. Right? You can start to let your heart be reassured that this is real, that I'm living in the truth. Because God is love. And if God is love and we're living in love, he goes, you can rest in that. Are you going to do that perfectly? Anybody here love perfectly? Not a one, right? None of us is perfectly loving. And that's where John is to this concern. He goes, that's where it comes in verse 20. When your heart condemns you. Hey, we know better. We should be doing this. We should be on that. And yet we're not. And so there's this struggle. And John says in the bottom line is we don't need to stay there. So if you're struggling with your faith this morning, if there's some doubts that have been going around, and maybe even a brother or sister or somebody else has cast some doubt on you, and maybe it's not just you, maybe it's a brother or sister, maybe it's the enemy, right? He's casting this doubt. Right? John goes, I don't want you to stay there. And I don't want you to stay there. And I want you to move past that. Examine it. See it for what it is. If there's truth in it, and we'll look at that, right? Confess that truth. If your conscience is bringing forth conviction, deal with it. But don't stay there and let it keep holding you back from moving forward in your relationship with Christ, because he doesn't. So verse 19 points us back to that. When you're troubled by doubts and self-condemnation, fix it. Don't sit there and ponder. How many of us do that? I do at times. I did do something wrong. I know I should have done this or I should have done that, and I didn't. And I should, if I dealt with it in that moment, this is the crazy thing, right? If we would confess in that moment, I believe we could get past it a lot quicker. I really do. Right? If the moment that our conscience comes forth and brings forth that, that conviction, or the Holy Spirit comes forth and brings conviction, if we dealt with it then, we could move forward. When we sit and let it dwell, right, and we stew on it a little bit, and we cram it down and go, I can get past this, whatever, and all of a sudden it starts to take root. Right, and all this thought that you're insufficient or not adequate, or maybe I'm not a son, because how could a son possibly do that? It starts to take root in our lives, and it starts to drive our decision making. It starts to drive how we act with other people. And John goes, don't do that. Process it and move forward. But instead, look at the times that God's love has moved through. Has God's love moved through you? Have you seen it? Experienced it? I guess as you all have. That you've seen moments, you've had times in your life that you've watched God's love flow through you to somebody else. In your immediate family, in this body of believers, in your workplace, in your school. He goes, go back to those. Right? Be encouraged that if you're seeing those things taking place in your life, you can put your hearts at rest, right? Allow yourself to be assured that that's going forth. So let me ask you a question. I do a little bit of a homework assignment here, or in-class assignment, maybe not homework, because we'll do it here for a second. I'll give you a time. Name 5 times you failed, right? Think about that, right? If you have a paper or a pencil, go ahead and write it down, but name 5 times you failed. Failed God, failed others, right? I didn't have to think long, right? The list was long, right? But on the flip side, let me ask this question. Have you think about this, right? Name 5 times you've experienced God's victory. So you got 5 times that you've failed, 5 times that we've experienced God's victory. I think when you think about it, at least, and I went through it, the list of failures was so fast, right? The list of times that God worked through me, sometimes you have to think a little longer, okay, where was that? And some of those maybe don't come as easy or as readily, right? And so I want to encourage you, right, to maybe spend some time this week sitting down and reminding ourselves, okay, yes, these are the times that I failed. These are the times that I've seen God's victory. And these are the times that I've been obedient and walking in love, and I've seen him work through me, right? And build that list of yourselves of the times that God has been working through you that you get to go back. And, you know, the next week, and the conscience comes in when you fail, and you go, yeah, I know. I fell short, right? I am human. I get it, right? I'm still a sinful, broken human being, right, that still struggles with sin at times, that, you know, doesn't walk in the perfect righteousness of Christ all the time. But there's all this evidence, all this proof that I do love and that I am walking in Christ and that we need to be reminded of so that when that conscience gets active, we have something to combat it. Right? We have to have something to be able to go back to and start to realize. And that's what John is saying. He goes, by this, right? By the fact that you're loving brothers and sisters practically, you put our hearts at rest. Now, this isn't just self-talk. But if you're sitting here this morning and you really, really struggled with finding, you know, 5 times that I had his victory, that I loved other people, right? And if you're sitting here this morning and you're going, I don't know. I can't really put a finger on any of them. Maybe we should examine our hearts a little deeper. Right? Because if we can't point to situations where we love and where we've had victory in Christ, then maybe we don't have victory in Christ. Because if we love God and we're saved and we're children of the Father who loves and Christ loves us and he laid down his life, But we're not seeing that. Maybe we're not his children. Right? That's what John is talking. He's challenging us. He goes, be careful, right? By this you'll know you're my, but you set your hearts at rest. You're loving people. If you're not loving people, maybe your heart should be a little unsettled. Maybe you should be a little bit uneasy. And if that's you this morning, I want to encourage you to take that time with the Holy Spirit and ask him to remind you of things. And see if it's true. And see if that love is real inside of you. Which brings us to verse 20. The second truth by which we may assure our hearts is that God is greater, has greater knowledge of us. Verse 20 says this. For whenever our hearts condemn us, God is greater than our heart, and he knows everything. Our conscience is a God-given tool, correct? We've been given a conscience, and it serves a purpose. The problem is that conscience is wired and instructed and informed by the things we put in. Right? So if we're not putting in truth, right? If we're not putting in the word, what's our conscience being informed by? Things of the world, methods of the world, whatever, right? And so our conscience is God-given, and a lot of times our conscience does well in that fact that it brings forth, conviction, or brings forth this awareness of sin. But sometimes our conscience falsely accuses us, does it not? Am I the only one who's been down that road where the conscience is just welling, and it seems as though I've never done anything right? Or I've just really been in this spot, right? And the conscience brings forth this nonstop. It's no longer conviction. It's now condemnation. Going, how could you possibly be a son of God and do that? Ever hear that in your heart? Right? How could you possibly be that way? Right? And you're like, well, no, I got this one. And then you do something completely wrong again, and you fall into sin, or you stumble, or you don't love again, and your conscience goes, see, you're just proving my point. And left alone, it just continues to flow. And before we know it, we're down this path. My conscience is right. Maybe I'm not a believer. Maybe I'm just fooling myself. Maybe I'm just going to church. Because we don't allow it to possibly stop. But here's the thing, as sons and daughters, right, we need to be aware of this truth, as it says in verse 20. Right? God is greater than our hearts or our conscience or mind. He's greater than that. He knows everything. How many of us knows everything we've done wrong? How many of us have long lists of the things we've done wrong? Right? I mean, unfortunately, we have these lists, but we don't know everything. Right? And so we're condemning, our mind is condemning, and we go, you know what? God knows all of it. And yet he doesn't condemn us as believers, correct? Romans 8:1. Right, go ahead and flip there. Flip in your Bibles. Romans chapter 8. Right, we need to go back to the Lord, knowledge of the Lord, and have our conscience to be directed by it. Romans chapter 8, verse 1. At the next time that your heart or your conscience, one and the same, starts to come in and bring these accusations and condemnation, right, we need to have this tool, this verse at the ready. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Right? And there's none. Zero. So the next time that you are putting yourself and allowing condemnation to come in, right, check it for a minute. Where is this coming from? Because my Lord doesn't condemn me. If I'm in Christ, yes, I've screwed up. Yes, I've fallen short. Yes, you sinned. But he doesn't condemn you. You need to fix it. You need to confess. Right? You need to repent. But there's not condemnation coming your way. Condemnation isn't coming from the Lord. Condemnation comes from yourself, from your own conscience, or it comes from the enemy. That's it. We talked Wednesday night a little bit about this. We got into this discussion a little bit. And we started talking about the difference between condemnation and conviction. Is there a difference? Is there a difference between condemnation and conviction? Right? And I believe there is, right? And I think it was my cousin who gave me this definition of the two, right? Condemnation, right, pushes me away from Christ. Conviction draws me to Christ. Right? So when you have this going on in your mind or in your heart, you're sitting there going, what am I experiencing right now? Am I experiencing condemnation? Am I experiencing conviction? Ask yourself, am I wanting to draw close to the Lord? Am I wanting to shrink back and hide from the Lord? Right? It's important how you answer that question, because if you want to shrink back and hide from the Lord, what you're experiencing is condemnation and shame and guilt. And not that that can't help at times to shift us to repent, but conviction is much better at it. Right? Conviction brings us in and it makes us aware, and conviction at the same time brings us to the truth of that it was already paid for in Christ, and that our Father is at the ready to forgive. And he goes, now I want to draw close to Jesus so I can get rid of this item of sin in my life. Condemnation wants me to hide in the corner and keep it, because there's no way my Father could love me. And I say that from a perspective of, you know, we can look at little kids. So anybody who's a parent, right, when children come to know that they're lovingly, you know, that they're loved and there isn't condemnation, right, early on they may be at the spot they go and hide. I did something wrong, I got to go hide. It's not healthy. Right? It's not healthy. That's not the way it's meant to be. Right? Our kids, if they know they're wrong, right, they should desire to come to mom and dad and to confess that and to get it cleansed and to get it cleaned up and dealt with. Because there's no condemnation. And so inside the body of Christ, we have to encourage one another in that as well. That we can't condemn one another. We have to constantly be building one another up and assuring one another that there isn't condemnation. Because the amazing thing is that in Romans 8, if you're still there, right, Paul continues to push on in this discussion of no condemnation. You come to verse 31. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son but gave him up for us, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? Right? All of these things. Who should do that? Who can bring those kinds of charges? So when your mind, when your heart, when your conscience starts to bring accusation, go, you know what? You don't have a right to flip that accusation at me. That's God's job. The Holy Spirit will bring forth the conviction that I need to draw me to Christ. I don't have to allow my conscience, and you don't have to allow your conscience to continue to heap on guilt and shame. Because then he continues on in chapter 8 and he says, you know, what can separate us from the love of God? Is there something that you believe can separate you from the love of God? You're all going, nope, I know the right answer, Pastor. There is nothing that can separate me from the love of God. Right? Intellectually, I think you all agree with me that that's true. How many practically believe there's things that separate you from the love of God? Right? There's times that I live my life as though I have now separated myself, that I've done something so wrong that God's not going to love me. Right? And it's not until the Holy Spirit brings conviction and goes, John, what are you doing? What are you thinking? That's not your Father. Or a brother or sister comes along because you sit down with them, you have a conversation, and you're like, here's what I'm struggling with. I'm really believing that, you know, I don't believe God loves me right now. And they remind us of some verses that say that's not true. And it brings you back and you go, you're right. Intellectually, nothing will separate me. Practically, things do. And those are things we have to fight against. Right? We have to fight against those things that practically push us away into guilt and shame, especially our conscience that brings forth conviction all the time. And then the second story, then there's another analogy of this. Flip with me to the book of John, Gospel of John. Paul has that statement about no condemnation. Most of us here this morning probably know the story of Peter. Peter denied Jesus 3 times, correct? Right? Jesus himself tells Peter, you're going to do this. Peter's like, not me. I'm all in. I got it. I'll die with you, man. I'm in. And maybe some of us have done that same type of mindset with Christ in our own walks with him. God, I'll never desert you. I'll never deny you. And yet we do. Right? And then guilt and shame starts to well up. How could I possibly do that? Right? Our conscience kicks in. Right? All of those things start to kick in. So we're in John 21, and you know, Peter's gone ahead and denied him. The rooster had crowed. Jesus is dead, buried, resurrected. Right? Peter's in the boat. Jesus sees him at the beach. Peter hops out of the boat, jumps in the water, like, I gotta get to Jesus because I know who that is. And we come to verse 15 of John chapter 21. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" And he said, "Yes, Lord." And he says, "Feed my sheep," right? And then in verse 16, Jesus asks Peter again, "Peter, do you love me?" Peter's like, "Yes, Lord, I love you." And then we come to verse 17. He said to them a third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me? Love me." Look at what Peter's response was. Peter was grieved. Right? Peter was grieved. Peter's sitting here going, "Yeah, I do. How, you know, you're asking me again," but at the same time, his conscience, right? He's grieved. He's broken that he denied Christ, and he knows he denied Christ. And I could see myself sitting in that same kind of a spot over times that God has asked me to do something, and I'm grieved, and I'm like, yes. But see, where does Peter yield to? Where does Peter go with his thought process? Right, so he's grieved, and he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said, Peter responding to the Lord, he said to him, "Lord, you know everything." Sounds a lot like 1 John, right? God is greater than your heart this morning, church. Right, so when your condemnation comes in, right, when the conscience kicks in and brings forth condemnation, we need to be reminded God is greater and he knows it all. Peter looks at him and goes, "You know what? I've denied you these times. I'm broken. I'm grieved. I know I'm wrong. You're asking me these questions." And he goes, "Jesus, you know that I love you. You know everything." So he appeals to Christ and he goes, "Jesus, you know." And what does Peter tell him? Right? Or what does Jesus tell him? He goes, "Feed my sheep." Right? "Feed my sheep." He carries it on. He goes, "Yes, Peter, I know where you've been. I know how much you've denied me. I know how grieved you are. But I know you love me." Right? And he knows the same of you and me in this room, right? If we're truly his. Right? Our Father knows everything. And he's chosen to forgive you anyways. Right? There is no sin so great that the blood of Christ doesn't cover it. Right? I don't care what your conscience says. I don't care what your neighbor might say to you. I don't care what the devil says to you, right? It doesn't matter. There's nothing so great that the blood of Christ can't cover it. And John is going, so don't go down that path. I want you to be assured that as much as you're grieved, as much as your conscience is condemning you, your Father doesn't. Right? We don't need to live as defeated people. Yes, we fall short. Yes, we sin. Yes, we're not perfect. Our God knows that. Right? And he goes, "You know what? I love you anyways. I gave my son for you anyways. So don't live a defeated life. Own it, yes. Own your sin. Right? Process that sin. Confess that sin. Live as though 1 John 1:9 is true." What's 1 John 1:9? Right? If you confess your sins, he is what? Gracious and just to forgive us all sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness, right? We've talked about it. Do we believe that that's true? Do we live like that's true? That if I confess, it's white, covered by the blood. Or instead our conscience goes like this, no, don't confess it. Go hide in the corner because you know what? That sin is too good, too big. And our conscience brings condemnation. John's going, don't do that. Come forth. God's aware of that. He's calling you out of that spot to get it cleaned up. And allow him to cleanse it through the blood of Christ. And so he knows every sin that you have done. And our God knows every sin that you will do. Things that you're not even aware of yet. Right? There's sins that I'm going to do in the rest of my life that I'm not aware of yet. God is. He's going, I don't condemn you. Conscience might, but I don't. Right, so let's live in the freedom that we have, that God is greater than our conscience. He's greater than our hearts going forward. And I think that as we get into that spot, as we gain this assurance, as we gain this comfort, not that we're presuming upon God's grace in any way, shape, or form. Please don't hear that from me this morning, that the pastor says God doesn't really care about sin. He does. Right? Obviously, he cares enough to send his son to die. And obviously, it's a pretty big deal to him, right? So I'm not saying that at all, but once we get this assurance that there's no condemnation in Christ anymore, And we have this assurance because we're seeing love for the brethren come out, for our hearts are at peace that it's real. I'm not just saying something. I'm not just saying I love God. I'm not just saying I'm a believer. I'm actually a believer. There's some blessings that come out of that place of assurance. That brings us into verses 21 through 24. Beloved, if our heart does not condemn us, we have confidence before God. Right? So there's two things that kind of give confidence in that path that we'll see in 22 and 23 and then verse 24. The first is answered prayer in verses 22 and 23. And the other, that of an abiding relationship through the Spirit in verse 24. Right? And there's one scholar puts it out there this way, and he summarizes these verses. He goes, the thought here is that of the boldness with which a son appears before the Father, and not that of which the accused appears before the judge. Right, there's a difference. Right, there's a confidence that comes in, and I came across this story that somebody else had kind of quoted from Our Daily Bread, and I know some of you guys in here at least use Our Daily Bread for discussions on Wednesday morning. Maybe many others read that little devotional booklet that's out there. Quite a while back in the Daily Bread, he had this story that kind of drives home this thought process. He goes, there's a Roman emperor who was parading through the streets of the capital in a victory celebration. Roman soldiers lined the parade route to keep back the cheering masses. At one point along the route, there was a small platform where the royal family was sitting. As the emperor approached, his youngest son, who was just a little boy, jumped down, burrowed through the crowd, and tried to run out to meet him. Right? You can almost kind of picture, right? Dad's coming home, right? I'm going. And he hops off the stage. He's like, I'm out. I'm getting in there. Some way, shape, or form, I'll weave my way through. You can kind of see the picture, right? He says this. He goes, as he's running through, he goes, one of the guards caught the boy by the arm and said, you can't do that. Don't you know who that is? That's the emperor. Right? Guards are doing their duty. It's not the guard's fault, but it's true, right? You don't just approach the emperor. You just don't do those types of things. Right? Those are places of reverence. And yet he goes, this little boy, he goes, that's the emperor. But the boy quickly replied, he may be your emperor, but he's my father. Right? There's a big difference between the two. Right? There's a big difference in the way we see it. When we start to understand that God is our father, that he's Abba, he's saying it this morning, right? He's Abba, this term of endearment, this closeness, this intimacy that's taking place. He's not just God. He's not just, you know, no, he's daddy. He's my father. I have a relationship with him as a son does, and it's healthy, and it's good, and we can approach him with that kind of boldness. And we're meant to. And I believe John wants you and I to understand that so we can have that kind of confident access with the king. Right? We have that relationship that flows forth, and he brings forth in 22, right? Whatever we ask, we receive from him. Is that your experience? Struggle with that at times, right? Because there's a lot of things that I've prayed for, asked for, haven't received, and maybe you have too, right? But John says in verse 22, right, and whatever we ask, we receive from him. And it would be great if, you know, John just left it there. John isn't creating something new here. He's not taking prayer and going, here, I got this new revelation that's out there, because if we were to go back to the Gospel of John, all John really is doing is repeating what he heard his Lord say. Right, in chapter 14 of John, verses 13 and 14, it says, whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. So John's like, I heard Jesus say this. If I ask for anything in his name, he'll do it. Right, so John's repeating that. And unfortunately, so often in the church anymore, it's been going on for centuries, mind you, it's like, well, if I just throw in Jesus' name at the end, then he's got to answer it. Right? Instant silver bullet, instant answered prayer. In Jesus' name, I'm done. I get it. Not the way it works, right? I think we know that. At least if you've been in the church, you're walking with the Lord at any duration of time. That's not the way it works, right? The Bible doesn't teach that we can add Jesus' name at the end and the genie pops out of the bottle and grants you the wish, right? That's not the way it works. John doesn't say it works that way either here in verse 22. Right? What does he say in verse 22? The reason we receive. Whatever we ask, we receive from him. Comma, right? Sentence is still going. Thought process is still going, right? Whatever we ask, we receive from him because we keep his commandments and do what pleases him. Pastor, are you saying that prayer, answered prayer is conditional? No, I'm not. I'm reading what God says in his word. That's all I'm doing. I'm repeating what God said. Now, is that a hard, fast rule that God never answers prayer of an unbeliever or somebody who's, you know, in sin? I'm not saying that. But if we want to increase the percentage, I guess, if you will, are we walking in a close, intimate relationship with the Lord? Are we being obedient? Are we doing what pleases Him? Because John says very clearly, whatever we ask, we receive from Him because we keep His commandments and do what pleases Him. What pleases Him? Loving brothers and sisters? Yep, that pleases Him. Walking in obedience to the things He's commanded, all of them? Yep, that pleases Him. So I think back to when I was a little kid, right? And I'm in with my father, and my father asked me to do something, and I'm like, never mind. I don't want to do it. Right? Clean your room, do whatever. No, I'm not doing that. Right? And maybe some of you have been in that spot. Did you, when Dad got home, hadn't done what he asked you to do, did you run to him and go, hey, Dad, can you go buy me? Did we do that? My guess is no. Because we knew enough that I didn't do what Dad asked me to do. So it's pretty fruitless for me to go up and put a request before my father and go, hey, Dad, can you go buy me this? When I haven't been obedient. Right? And so if it doesn't happen in the earthly realm, now, was there times my dad still bought me something? Yes, of course. Right? There were still times he was generous and he looked past. But I knew there was a much better chance of getting a positive response if I was obedient to the things he asked me to do that day than not. And my guess is parents in here, every one of you has probably been in that same boat. Are your kids are doing what you're asking them to do? Sure, let's go do that. Right? You haven't done it? Well, if you go finish cleaning your room, then maybe we can go do it. Right? It happens. And unfortunately, I believe that it's the same thing with our Father in heaven at times. Right? Our prayer is hindered. Our prayer is an answer. Because we're living in presumption. We're living in blatant disregard for Christ. He goes, why do I want to answer that? Why am I going down that road? Well, He's God. He's supposed to do all those types of things, right? He's supposed to answer them. He says, no, that's not the way it works. Hey, flip with me, if you have your Bibles, go ahead and flip with me, if you will, to the book of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 1. Right, as much as God answers prayer for those who are obedient, I believe the flip side is also true, at least many times. Isaiah chapter 1. Look at a few verses just to kind of bring this point home. Verse 15. Israelites are there, they're putting all this stuff, they're walking in iniquity, they're not doing the things, right? This whole chapter is wickedness of Judah. You come to verse 15, when you spread out your hands, and basically mean when you spread out your hands in prayer, what does he say he'll do? I will hide my eyes from you. Even though you make many prayers, I will not listen. Oh, wait a minute. God, you're not going to listen because of why? Your hands are full of blood. You're not doing the things I asked of you people. And he goes, so you're going to pour out prayers to me, and I'm not going to listen to you. Ouch. So, if we think about our own lives practically, right, if we're living in blatant sin, do we think that God's going to hear now? He didn't listen to the Israelites then. But he's going to listen to us now, right? Things have changed. Same God. Hasn't changed. Right? If we want to live in disregard, then he goes, I can't really hear well. You go, well, is that true? Is it continued on? Yes. Go ahead and slide a little bit farther in the book of Isaiah. Slide over to Isaiah 59. Isaiah 59. We have this blessing of answered prayer out here that John is bringing us to, but on the flip side, right, we should be realizing that that's true as well. 59, verse 1, behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save, or his ear dull that he cannot hear. Right? So it's verse 1, right? God is not changed. He can still hear, he can still save. There's nothing beyond reach. But what does it say in verse 2? But your iniquities have made a separation between you and your God. And your sins have hidden his face from you so that he does not hear. Right? Our lifestyle impacts the effectiveness of our answered prayer. I really do believe that. And I'm not saying that God can't answer him anyways. He's God. I'm not going to put a limitation on him in that regard. But there's numerous places. You could go to Psalm 66. You'll find the same thing. Psalm 66, verse 18. Right? That you've been hearing and praying. He goes, I don't hear you. I'm not listening. Right? And so, yes, God hears the prayer, but he's not inclined to respond to said prayer. Because we're operating out of that place of a sinful lifestyle and a broken fellowship with him. And that request maybe just isn't heard as well. And so John is bringing that to bear on our love with one another, verse 17 and 18, right? If we love one another, he goes, so if you're not loving one another, right? Maybe God doesn't hear quite as well. Or he doesn't answer quite as well. Right? And so there's an encouragement that comes from living in a right request. And then flip with me to 1 Peter. Right? Well, that's all Old Testament. God was a little bit more judgmental back then. Right? They had to do these things and don't do these things. Go to 1 Peter chapter 3. And for those of us men who are married, maybe we need to take this verse very seriously. For those of men who, young guys that are here that might get married, take this to heart now. Right? 1 Peter chapter 3. How we treat our wives affects our prayer life. Right? It affects our connection with the Father. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 7. Likewise, husbands, right? Live with your wives in an understanding way, showing honor to the woman as the weaker vessel, since they are heirs with you of the grace of life, so that your prayers may not be what? Hindered. Right? So how I treat my wife, how I live with my wife, has a direct effect on my prayer life with the Lord. Right? Guys are going, stop. Right? We don't need to go. No, it does, guys. Right? How we treat them, how we live with them, Peter himself says directly, under the guidance, under the direction of the Holy Spirit, he goes, live with them so that your prayers may not be hindered. Right? So if you've been sitting here this morning or in the last few weeks, you're like, man, it just seems like all my prayers just hit the ceiling. They don't go anywhere. I want to encourage you. What's your life showing right now? What's your relationship and your obedience look like to the Lord? Right? In your home, if that's, start there, right? Husbands, right? If you're a guy here this morning, you're going, my prayers just keep hitting the ceiling. How have you been responding to your wife? Who, by the way, is whose daughter? Right? Because my guess, right? Let's just bring, it's not in my notes here, so I'm just going to go off cuff here a bit, but, right? Earthly fathers, raise your hand. Mitchell, I think you're about the only one that doesn't have a daughter right now. Pray that maybe the Lord blesses you with that at some point. But, right? Has a daughter, they get married, you find out their husband is treating them poorly. How many of us are going to bless our son-in-law? Says, oh, yeah, here, let's go have coffee. Let's go. I guess it's probably not many, right? We're going to be like, whoa, wait a minute. Now, you don't treat my daughter like that. That's not okay, right? You're not living well with her. You're not treating her well. Good luck, right? I'm not saying that we're breaking relationship, but there's a good chance I'm not going to respond readily to requests. It just doesn't work that way again. Right? And so it's the same with our Father, right? How we live with one another, church, affects our prayer life. Affects the way that God answers those prayers. Let's live in a way that we are effective in our prayer life and God desires to pour out that blessing down through us because we're what? We're living in obedience to his commands. Amazing thing is he doesn't leave us questioning what that command is. Right? Verse 22, and whatever we ask, we receive from him. Because we keep his commandments and do what pleases him. Right? Okay, well, what is that? Right? But he breaks it down in verse 23. He comes right back at it. And this is his commandment. Right? Here's what we need to do. Here's what we need to obey. Here's what's pleasing to him. That we believe in the name of his son, Jesus Christ, and love one another. Pretty simple, right? Two things. One commandment, right? Believe in Jesus, love one another. If you're doing those things, right, answered prayer is a lot more consistent, a a lot more logical, a lot more purposeful down this path. But at the same time, if you are, sitting here, right, and we're disobedient to God's command for love, well, I'm not real disobedient, right? One author says this. He goes, if we're harboring resentment and bitterness toward a brother or sister in Christ, God will not hear our requests. Right? If we're harboring bitterness and hatred towards a brother or sister in Christ, God doesn't hear requests. Or he hears them and he goes, I'm just going to put that request on the shelf for a minute. And when they finally yield to the conviction of the Holy Spirit, then I can maybe take that off and answer. But I'm going to withhold that answered prayer for a minute because they need to get this right first. Right? And so I just want to encourage you, if you haven't been maybe getting a whole lot of answered prayer, because John says we loves to do it, but if we have confidence before God, right, we ask whatever we want and we receive from him because it's in line with his will, it's in line with his purposes, it's in line with his plan, right, and he answers. If we're outside of that plan, there's a good chance you're not getting answered prayer because we're outside of plan, right? We're outside of the purpose. And then verse 24. Whoever keeps his commandments abides in God and God in him, right? So John has talked about our abiding in the previous chapter, chapter 2, right? But now he's talking about the fact that God now abides with us. He's, this is the first time. Now he's bringing the Father into the picture. He goes, if you're obedient to these commandments, that you will abide in God and the Father abides in you. That you have relationship. And what is abiding again? Abiding means to be at home with, correct? Be at home with, to stay with, right? To be in fellowship, if you will. And so if we're obedient to these commandments, he says, you'll have fellowship with the Father. How many of us desire to have fellowship with the Father? Right? Every one of us in this room should desire to have fellowship with the Father. He goes, you want fellowship with the Father? Then be obedient to the command. You'll have fellowship with the Father through Christ, because that's the only way we can obey the commandment is through Christ. Not earning your relationship with the Father, but because you're abiding in him and you're abiding in Christ and in that relationship, then you abide with the Father, and the Father sends the Spirit, correct? And so we know that we're abiding in him because he sends us the Holy Spirit. We have the Holy Spirit indwelling us. And now with this, this indwelling of the Holy Spirit, I'm not talking the mystical or the, not that that's bad at all, right? The feeling or the you know, the sensations and whatever else that people get with the presence of the Holy Spirit, right? Those aren't bad at all, right? That I don't believe that's the fullness that he's asking for. But if you have the Holy Spirit dwelling in you, the proof will be that you'll have his fruit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, right? All those things will start to flow out of you. And John's thought points to that fact. He says, so if we assure our hearts when they accuse and condemn us, we must look forward to the evidence of the Spirit's working, and particularly whether he is enabling us to believe in Christ, to obey God's commandments, and to love the brethren. Right? If we want to know that we have the Spirit of God living in us, look at what's coming out of us. If there's those things evident, we know we're walking after the Spirit. You can go to Galatians 5, I think it's 17 through 19, right? There's a fruit of the Spirit at the end of the chapter, but go just before that and look at the fruit of the, you know, of the flesh, right? The deeds of the flesh. And if that's what's marking your life, there's a good chance you don't have the Spirit. Instead, you can have the assurance that God abides in you when you see Christ-like character coming out of you. And there's another blessing, is that abiding, is that relationship that comes. So in closing, bring us to this. D.L. Moody, famous Bible teacher out there, right? A pastor out there. He had a man that came to him one day and he was worried because he didn't feel saved. You have days you don't feel saved. And maybe not so often anymore, but maybe in the past, whatever. Right? You've been walking with the Lord longer. Maybe you have, excuse me, maybe you struggle with that regularly. I don't know. I don't feel saved. So this man says, I don't feel saved. Moody asked, was Noah safe in the ark? Never thought to go down this path. Was Noah safe in the ark? Certainly he was, the man replied. But what made him safe, his feeling or the ark? I think of the flood, right? Here's Noah, right? He's in the ark. The man agrees that, yes, he's 100% safe inside of the ark. And Moody goes, what made him safe? His feeling that he was safe or the ark itself? Obviously, it's the ark itself, right? He could feel safe all day long. If he's not in the ark, he's dead. right? But because he's in the ark, whether he feels safe or not doesn't matter, because he's safe. And it's the same thing with our relationship with the Lord. But it doesn't matter if you feel safe. It's a joy, it's a pleasure when you do have that experience and everything within you knows. But your salvation and the assurance of heaven isn't based off of our feelings. Our feelings are fickle. Jeremiah 17:9, I believe it is, says that our hearts are deceitful. Right? They're wicked. Right? They're constantly at war with us, that unfortunately it seems at times. Right, so don't base your assurance of salvation off of how you feel today. That's what John is telling us this morning. He goes, that assurance is not assurance at all. The assurance that you can go to is the fact that you're obedient to loving your brother and sister, and it puts you at rest that you're in truth. Right, because love like that doesn't happen apart from Christ. It only happens through him. And so don't put, you know, don't allow your conscience, don't allow your heart, don't allow your feelings to drive you. So if you can relate to that fact that you're questioning, I don't feel safe, right? It's okay to make that statement. It's not okay to stay there. What do you do with it? Allow that to shift and move on. And so you sit there and go, if you're confident you're saved, yes, based off of what? What's your confidence rest in? John says let it rest in the fact that you have a relationship with Christ, and that relationship is leading towards loving your brothers and sisters. Seeing evidence thereof. And if you're seeing that evidence, you can rest assured that you have a relationship with the Father. Let's close up with prayer. Father God, we thank you for the truth of John's word. We thank you for the assurance that it brings. That each one of us here this morning can examine our lives. That by this, by our love for one another, by our loving with deed and truth, that we can put our hearts at rest before you. That we're walking with you. That our salvation is secure. That we have a relationship with you that is eternal. Father, I pray that for brothers and sisters here this morning who maybe have a conscience that's overactive. I know for myself, my own conscience struggles with that at times. It's overactive. It won't let things go. We struggle to put them aside. Lord, I pray that in those moments, Father, that we would remind ourselves that you're greater than that. You're greater than our conscience. You know everything. And that we don't allow our consciences to condemn us. We don't have to continue to believe that lie. Yes, if it's true, we need to acknowledge what their conscience is saying is true and confess it. But once it's confessed, let us live in the fullness of the forgiveness that is granted through Jesus Christ. That we no longer have to allow it to control our lives, no longer allow us to push us out of fellowship with you because we feel condemned. But that instead each one of us here this morning would have assurance to enter into your presence. A confidence like that little boy in the story we read about running to the emperor. That we would have that kind of confidence to run because, yes, you're God. Yes, you're King of Kings. Yes, you're Lord of Lords, but you're a Father. And that relationship is comes first. That we're your sons and your daughters. And you love to lavish us with your love and with your blessing as we walk in the ways that you've commanded us. Lord, help us to walk in those ways. Help us to love one another in increasing fashion. That we would have that kind of confidence before you. That we would know that when we ask in accordance with your will, we already have that answered prayer on the way. That we would constantly come to you for that peace.